afternoon. I hope you had a great weekend. Certainly enjoyed the winter is treating us really well with this great weather. So last Friday, we started talking about principal component analysis. And by and large, we said that the goal was going to be the following. We were going to be given a random variable x, and we were going to assume that it was zero mean, so the expected value of x was zero. And our goal was to find a linear projection of x, denoted by this vector u sub 1, such that it produces the largest possible variance. And what we demonstrated was that finding the direction that maximizes the variance is equivalent to solving some quadratic problem, where sigma x is the covariance matrix of the random variable x. And we demonstrated that the direction, the optimal direction, is given by what, from now on, this is a weird way of saying, is the largest eigenvector of a matrix. Obviously, that doesn't make any sense. All eigenvectors have the same length, and the length is equal to 1. So I'm going to use this weird wording to denote, not to be writing forever, is the eigenvector corresponding to the largest eigenvalue. That's what I really mean, but from now on, I'm just going to say the largest eigenvector. But we're going to understand each other, but that means that it corresponds to the largest eigenvalue. Okay? So I went through the proof of that in the previous lecture. So that's our starting point for today. So what we're going to do today is to move now. Suppose that we want to compute many principal components for the data. So the D, so this is the definition, the D principal components of the random vector x are y sub I is equal to u sub I times x. So it's going to be d linear components of x. And linear components is just take the random vector and project it according to a linear projection, such that the y sub I are uncorrelated and have maximum variance. Okay, so that's the intuitive definition of what principal components are. Again, our most intuitive definition is it's just linear projections of the data that maximize the variance, or we want to find D components in the data that have the largest variance. But that would not be enough, so we're going to need a little bit more. They need to be linear components, they need to be uncorrelated with each other, and in addition to maximizing the variance, which is what we want. Okay? So how do we formulate that problem? So the first thing, which we already know, right, that I did in the previous class, is that the variance of the I component is simply going to be u sub I transpose sigma x u sub I. That the proof of that fact is identical for one component, so for the I component is the same. There is absolutely no difference. The second one is, what does it mean to be uncorrelated? When is it the case that two random variables are uncorrelated? The entries are zero. The entries of the covariance matrix are zero. Okay? So recall, in this particular case, the variance of x is equal to sigma x. Okay? And this is meant to be the expected value of x, x transpose. But, okay, but maybe this is not for x, this is being said for y. So what covariance matrix are we talking about? What entries are zero? So first of all, I need to apply to y, not to x, okay? And so what you said is that the which entries are zero? The diagonal entries? No. Off diagonal entries need to be zero. Okay. So because here the expected value of y sub I is equal to the expected value of ui transpose x, which is ui transpose the expected value of x, which is zero. So because the y sub I are zero mean, then uncorrelated means really that the expected value of yi times yj needs to be zero, right? So this thing translates into that. Okay? The expected value of the product of them needs to be zero. That's the in theory, uncorrelated would have been the expected value of yi minus its mean, yj minus its mean. Okay? But the means are zero. That's what I computed for. So that's why it reduces to just the expected value of the product is zero. Okay, so what is the expected value of the product? This is the expected value of y sub I. Y sub I is going to be ui transpose x. Okay? Yj, that is going to be x transpose yj. Everybody agrees with what I just wrote? Yes? Okay? So the same thing I did last time. We can take constant outside of the expectation. Right? And this gives us ui transpose sigma x uj. So my second set of constraints is going to tell me that this is equal to zero. Okay? So now, in our particular case, I already have the result for the first principal component. I already proved to you in the last class that it is the largest eigenvector. So I actually already know u sub 1. So let's say that I want to do this thing one by one. Let's say that I already know u1, but I'm going to try to compute u2 right now, the second principal component. So if I try to compute the second principal component, right, what I want is effectively to maximize the variance of y2 subject to, well, I know that the u2 transpose u2 needs to be equal to 1, right? I'm searching for a direction again. Yet the u vectors are always unit norm. But in addition, I have this constraint, okay? And this constraint means that 0 is equal to, let's say, u1 transpose sigma x u2, right? Agreed? That's what this constraint says. Okay. All right. But as it turns out, I already know that sigma x times u1, what is sigma x times u1? I take the covariance matrix and I apply it to the vector u1. What is the vector u1? It's the eigenvector corresponding to the largest eigenvalue. That's what we already proved. So what is sigma times u1? Huh? Lambda? 1, u1, right? Because u1 is an eigenvector. Is that correct? Yes. Okay. So as a consequence, this constraint now reduces to u1 transpose u2 is equal to 0, no? Okay? Because lambda 1, supposedly, okay, supposedly the lambda 1 is the largest one. I'm going to assume that it's bigger than 0, in fact. And so, right, is that clear? This times that is equal to that. So, okay, maybe I should have done it in various steps, but this means that u1 transpose sigma x is equal to lambda 1 u1 transpose. So all of this quantity gets replaced by just u1, effectively, because I got lambda 1. But the lambda 1 is not 0, so I just cancel. That's what I did. Okay. Okay. So what this hopefully demonstrates to you is that u1 and u2 need to be are two vectors, and what property they need to satisfy? They need to be orthonormal to each other. So typically when you learn PCA and you don't know everything that is under the hood, you say, oh, it's, you know, a bunch of orthogonal vectors. The principal components are orthogonal to each other. So it isn't quite like that in principle. The basic definition really is a statistical problem, and you're searching for variables that are uncorrelated with each other. And it happens that once you write it down, that property of being uncorrelated gets converted into being orthogonal, okay? But it's only because the solution for the first one was an eigenvector. And because it is an eigenvector, once you substitute it in the equation, then the sigma disappears and you just get the orthogonality constraint, okay? So that's how we go from uncorrelated to orthogonal. So the bottom line is that I end up with the following optimization problem. The variance of y2, I already have the expression for the variance. It's written right there. So I need to maximize u2 transpose sigma 2 u2 subject to u2 transpose u2 is equal to 1 and u1 transpose u2 is equal to 2. That's the new optimization problem. Okay. So I'm going to try to solve that right now. Okay, so constraint optimization problem, what did we say we do? Lagrange tells us that we need to do objective plus lambda times the constraint. That's what we need to do. So I'm going to take the objective function. So the Lagrangian is going to be u2 transpose sigma x u2 plus lambda times the constraint. So lambda times 1 minus u2 transpose u2. But then I have two constraints right now. So I need to add one Lagrange multiplier per constraint. So let me say that I add gamma and then u1 transpose u2. So I have two Lagrange multipliers, one per constraint. So I need to compute the derivative of L with respect to u2. Okay. And u1, by the way, the u1 is now fixed, okay? I already computed. The u1 is in the top left, is the largest eigenvector of sigma x. So I compute the derivatives. We went through this in the previous class. So what is the derivative of this first term? All right, I forgot, but you know, it's like quadratic, so it's sigma u squared. What is the derivative of sigma u squared? 2 times sigma u. All right. So 2 times sigma u. All right? Good. Second term, that's kind of u squared. What is the derivative of u squared? 2 times u, right? So minus 2 times lambda u2. All right? Last term, a little bit different, but bottom line is the dot product of a constant vector with the variable. So it's linear. So it's like the derivative of a times x, right? So what is the result for the third term? plus gamma times
U1.
Okay, so I'm sure you're gonna write that in the homework.
Okay.
Many of you will. But remember, you need to make sure this is column vector, column vector, column vector. Okay, so it needs to be like that. All right? Okay? And that needs to be equal to zero. Now, if I multiply everything by let's do the following. Let's multiply on the left by U1 transpose. Okay? What happens if I multiply on the left by U1 transpose? So what I get is 2 times U1 transpose sigma x U2 minus 2 times lambda U1 transpose U2 plus gamma U1 transpose U1 is equal to 0. Right? And this guy is a 1. Right? We all know that, because each one of the UIs is unit norm. U1 transpose U2, that is 0, so that's not there. So what do I get? Well, I kind of don't get anything because I already knew that this guy is 0, right? That was what I sort of derived over there. That's there, I'm correct. So I didn't get anything, right? Okay. Let me try multiplying by U2 transpose. Okay, so in this equation, I got 0 is equal to 0. So it was useless to do that projection. Let me do a second projection with U2. So I'm going to get 2 times U2 transpose sigma x U2 minus 2 times lambda U2 transpose U2 plus gamma U2 transpose U1 is equal to 0. Now, this is 0 for the same reason as before. This is minus 2 lambda. And this is now 2 U2 transpose sigma x U2. And so that plus that is equal to 0. So as before, we simply get that U2 transpose sigma x U2 is equal to lambda. So the bottom line is, as before, we are trying to maximize lambda. But before, what we had been able to show was that, let me see one moment. No. I went too fast here. Okay, let me redo what I just did. We are fine here, so U1 transpose that. So that equation was correct. And let me do the extra analysis that I did. That has a 1 there, right? That's clear. So that's gamma times 1. This one here has U1 transpose U2 times 0. So that's a 0. This one here has U1 transpose that and that. Okay? But that is 0 because of what I just said. But what does this equation say? It says 0 minus 0 plus gamma equals 0. So from this equation, I conclude that gamma is equal to 0. Okay? I went too quickly, and I missed the fundamental equation that I needed. So from the first equation, I get that gamma is 0. Is that clear? So, because gamma is 0, if I substitute it here, I'm going to get that sigma x u2 is equal to lambda times u2. Okay. Okay, so in basically, what am I doing? I'm trying to maximize the variance subject to the second principal component being uncorrelated with the first. I work down the problem, the gamma is zero. So it's almost as if the uncorrelated didn't play any role in so far, because I still got the same equation as before that says that the second principal direction also needs to be an eigenvector of sigma x, right? So this says u2 is an eigenvector of sigma x. So before I move on, you have a question?
The solution for gamma didn't actually limit you in finding that solution for u2, right? You could have derived that from multiplying again on the left by u2 in your bottom equation, could you not?
Not entirely, because in principle I've got this equation.
Mm-hmm.
That's just the full equation that I have to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
This first step allowed me to say that the gamma is zero,
mm-hmm.
and therefore arrive at that equation.
But you could have arrived at that equation from the very bottom relationship that you wrote here, right?
Not quite how.
Multiply again on the left by u2?
Here. Okay, so I could go from here to here. That is true.
Uh-huh.
But I could not go from here to there.
Why not?
Well, this is just a scalar equation. So how do I go back? Perhaps, maybe I'm wrong, perhaps what you're trying to tell me, well, I could have started with u2 transpose sigma x u2 equals to lambda u2 transpose u2, and then just get rid of these two. But that would, you go to jail for that.
No,
you cannot simplify those two.
I'm saying, why not just multiply, so given the equation you have in the box?
This one?
Yes. Why not just multiply both sides on the left by u2?
Because how do I get, so I would get a u2 there and a u2 here,
mm-hmm.
but how about this part? How do I say that that is equal to sigma x? That's not, it's just a scalar.
Well, doesn't the left side just reduce to 1?
That's what I thought.
u2 transpose 1.
Oh, it's the outer product, I see. Okay. Yeah, never mind. I thought you could reduce the u2 u2 transpose to 1, but it's the outer product.
So let me write this. So that's, and let me write this. Okay? So, bottom line, I've been able to demonstrate that in spite of the extra stuff, still u2 is an eigenvector, right? And because of this equation here, and that's what we need to maximize, still it should be an eigenvector that corresponds to the largest eigenvalue. So what's wrong? Well, what's wrong is that, I insist, you still have this other constraint. So what it really says is the following. Find a vector u2, okay, find a vector u2 that is an eigenvector of sigma, okay, that has the largest possible eigenvalue, but that is orthogonal to the first eigenvector you already computed. Okay? So I repeat, find an eigenvector that has the largest possible eigenvalue, but it needs to be orthogonal to the one you already have. Okay, so which eigenvector is that? Which eigenvector is that? Okay, so I remind you, the matrix sigma x is symmetric and positive semi-definite. Therefore, it has a basis of eigenvectors, and moreover, it has an orthogonal basis of eigenvectors. So it has an orthogonal basis of eigenvectors. Okay? So this means that I've got, you know, u1, u2, or maybe let me call them with different letters, v1, v2, v sub D in this particular case with corresponding lambda 1 through lambda D. Okay? So this is the one, and let's suppose that I ordered them. Lambda 1 is bigger than lambda 2, bigger than lambda 3, and so on and so forth. So this V1 is orthogonal to V2 and orthogonal to V3. Right? That's what I know because the matrix happens to be symmetric. So I took the first one. I now need to find a second eigenvector of all of these possibilities that is orthogonal to the first and has the largest possible eigenvalue. Which one would that be? Lambda 2. So what this shows is that U2 is the second largest eigenvector of sigma. Any questions so far? No? Good. So now what about the remaining principal components? I guess now you more or less are starting to get to what's going to happen now. Well, we're going to do it for the third, and it needs to be orthogonal to the first two, and after we do all of the Lagrange multipliers, two things are going to be zero instead of one. We're going to get the same thing over and over. Okay? So all the details of that are written in the book, and I think now you can just read it easily. But it's just more letters and more sums, but it's the same idea. So let me just write down the theorem that effectively says that the top D principal components y sub I equals ui transpose x, where ui is equal to the I largest eigenvector of sigma. Okay. So therefore, all I need to do is to compute the eigenvectors of the covariance matrix and select the largest D. And that's going to give me the directions u sub I that I need to use to project the random variables. Okay. What can go wrong, just to be a little bit clear, a few things can go a little bit wrong. And those are, well, is this unique? Will I always get the same projection? Are there cases where this won't be unique? So, that, of course, has to do with the question of, are the eigenvectors of that covariance matrix unique? Eigenvectors are never unique, are just defined up to scale, but I don't care because actually by assumption I assume that they all have unique norm, so that's not a problem. But the second thing is that an eigenvector versus minus the eigenvector, they're both the same direction, they have the same norm, but they are not the same vector. Okay. So what about that sign ambiguity? Well, what that's going to cause simply is that the y sub I random variable will become minus y sub I. So there's a sign ambiguity, which means that the ui can be replaced by minus ui. And so what that means is that y sub I will be replaced by minus y sub I. So that's one source of non-uniqueness. But that's not very relevant necessarily in practice, because the main direction at which, along which you are projecting data is the same. Okay. When you do interpretation for your specific application, maybe it will be of relevance, because then you will care. Like, for example, the principal modes of variations of pictures and their varying rotation. You know, one. If the method works, maybe we will discover that one mode of variability of the data is how much has the face rotated. And then it actually has a meaning, because it will be rotation to the right or rotation to the left. All I'm saying is that PCA has no clue about that. It just gives you the direction, and the sign of right or left is arbitrary. Okay. So when you want to interpret the data, particularly for biomedical applications, it will matter which sign you pick. But from the unsupervised learning perspective, it's irrelevant. The other one that it's often forgotten, which is ambiguity, is what happens when you have what if, for example, let me just talk about the top two. What if the top two eigenvalues are repeated? Do I get a unique set of eigenvectors in those cases when you have repeated eigenvalues? So in that particular case, you know, the definition of sigma x times u is equal to lambda u. That's the basic definition of an eigenvector. So look at what can happen in that particular case. If I have the corresponding u1 and u2, right, those are the, look at what can happen. What if I do the following calculation, sigma x times cos theta u1 plus sine theta u2. What happens with that calculation? Well, I am going to get cos theta u1 multiplied by lambda 1 plus sine theta u2 multiplied by lambda 2, in principle, right? That would be the generic case, okay? And maybe I should put that this is true here for I plus 1 and 2. Okay. So do I get, you know, the beauty of this is matrix times the vector. The vector remains the same, but it's multiplied by lambda I. Matrix times vector. Do I get the same vector, yes or no? Generically, no, because now what I have is something times u1 plus something times u2. I get a linear combination of u1 and u2 weighted by these sines and cosines. So in principle, this linear combination of u1 and u2 is not an eigenvector. Okay? Linear combinations of eigenvectors are not eigenvectors in general. But in the particular case where the eigenvalues are the same, right, this thing will become the same thing as lambda 1 times cosine theta u1 plus sine theta u2. Right? In that case, I can factorize the lambdas because they're the same. And in that case now, I've got sigma times the linear combination is equal to lambda times the same linear combination. So what that means is that this linear combination of u1 and u2, and in fact any linear combination of u1 and u2, is also an eigenvector. So the eigenvectors are not uniquely defined because any linear combination of them also produces another eigenvector. But moreover, the norm of these two, the norm of this guy, right, is equal to cosine squared times the norm of the first plus sine squared times the norm of the second. But these two guys are unit norm, so sine theta. So, and I forgot about theta again, so this is cos squared theta plus sine squared theta. That's one. So what I'm saying is that even the norm of the eigenvector is preserved. And I did this with cosines and sines, but I could have taken more. So the bottom line is the following. There are two eigenvectors that come in a pair, the first and the second. Any rotated version of them, so in particular, if I have u1 and I have u2, if I multiply by cosine and sine, but you believe me that I could have done minus sine and cosine, okay, are also two orthogonal eigenvectors. So what that means is that in this particular case of repeated eigenvalues, my principal components are not uniquely defined, are only defined up to our rotation, because I can take those two eigenvectors that are supposed to be orthogonal to each other, and I can rotate them by any angle theta, and they continue to be eigenvectors. And so nothing would change. Okay? So that's a rare case, because it really means that the variance of the data in two different directions is the same. Okay. But it can happen. But it's important to know that in those cases, your principal components are not uniquely defined. And so when you do your plots, you can rotate all of your data, and it should look the same. That's the basic case in terms of the distribution. Okay. More generally, you know, I talked here about two being repeated. But if I have one that is repeated three times, what would happen? Uniquely defined up to a three-dimensional rotation. If they're repeated four times, uniquely defined up to a four-dimensional rotation. So that's the basic quantity. So, in summary, the top principal components are given by the top D, or can be obtained from the top D eigenvectors of the covariance matrix. Those are uniquely defined up to sign ambiguity, and up to potential rotation whenever some eigenvalues are repeated. That's the change. So let me move now to the second topic of chapter 2 on PCA, which is geometric PCA. So far, we just talked about the statistical direction. And so the definition was, as I had it over there, is find directions that maximize the variance. That was the basic principle. Okay. What's good about it is that it has a solid statistical definition. It can be applied to random variables. But if you look at it and you look at the final theorem, to be able to compute them, I need to know the covariance of the random variable. I need to know the covariance of x. Okay. So in practice, if instead of you knowing a priori what that covariance matrix is, I just gave you data, you couldn't compute this because you wouldn't know the true covariance matrix of the population. So if you had to, what would you do? The typical approach would be I'll go from data to an estimate of the covariance, and then I would compute the eigenvectors. So that is actually what's called, maybe I should have actually written that down here before switching topics. I should have called this sample PCA, which simply means that I give you data, x1, xn, and these are samples, IID samples. Of x, okay? Then you go ahead and compute an estimate of the covariance, and typically that would be 1 over n, sum x1, xi, xi transpose, in this particular case, I goes to n. And now you compute the PCs, the principal components, from the sample covariance. That would be the approach to do it from there. Okay. But what could go wrong? Suppose that the data that I gave you was images. Suppose that I gave you now 1,000 images, each one of dimension 1,000,000. Okay? What is the dimension of that covariance matrix? Right? It's data. Data is dimension times 1. This is 1 times d. So this matrix is really d by d. Okay? So So in the example that I was telling you, this is images, and the dimension is a million. So you need to estimate a million by a million matrix. From n being the number of examples, which is just maybe 1,000 pictures. Okay? Do you think you're going to get a good estimate of that covariance matrix? What do you think? No, right? So if you look at classical statistics, almost any theory in classical statistics says, as the number of samples goes to infinity, right, my estimator is unbiased and is consistent and all of the beautiful properties that we all know. But in the real world, I might be in the opposite situation, where the dimension of the data is huge and the number of examples I'm given is very small. In those cases, coming up with a good estimate of that covariance might not, you know, what I've written there is a formula. It gives an estimate. But that estimate, is it close to the true covariance or is it not? It's only going to be close if capital N goes to infinity. But for a very small n, it might be very far. In fact, at most, you know, the rank of that matrix will not even be full rank. At most, it's going to be the number of samples in that same. So geometric PCA tries to address that by directly having a definition of principal components that is more geometric, so it doesn't depend on having to estimate a covariance matrix, and directly searches for principal components in the data. And the way it's done is as follows. The idea now is going to be that I'm given this set of data points, xj, j plus 1, n, where each xi belongs to a subspace, s. Yes. So pictorially, what that means is that there is some subspace there, and all my data points lie in that subspace. In practice, we're going to deviate from that picture a little bit, and there will be some noise associated with that subspace. So I will have some points that are a little bit outside. Okay. But the idea is that essentially there is this subspace. And now the dimension of this subspace is going to be little d, which is going to be akin to the number of principal components. And I'm going to assume that this dimension is much smaller than the other dimension, which is capital B. Okay. So I'm going to parameterize the subspace in terms of some parameters. So I'm going to say that the subspace S is the set of all points X's. And maybe the subspace doesn't go through the origin, so my origin could be here. So I can always parameterize these in terms of some point in subspace, which I'm going to denote by mu, and some basis for the subspace. So I'm going to denote this as the set of all points such that x is equal to mu plus some basis times y, where mu is any point in the subspace, so it belongs to S, and u is a matrix, or is a basis, so it's d by u. And y is the low dimensional coordinate on the subspace. Okay? So what I am trying to say here is that, you know, now I'm here, and this may be u1, this may be u2, and so for that point, I'm trying to write down its coordinates, that's going to be y1, and that's going to be y2. Maybe I went too fast for some of you, so I just want to intuitively remind you where does this come from? Why am I representing the subspace in this particular way? So you might just remember from high school the equation of a line, okay? And so one form of writing the equation of a line is just slope times x plus intercept. That you all remember from high school? Okay. A different way of writing the equation of a line when the origin is here, it's to say that the line, you pick a point in the line, I'm going to denote it mu, you pick the direction of the line, right? And so any point, maybe I'm going to put the mu here, so this is mu, any point here in the line, let me call that point x, is equal to the point mu plus lambda times this direction. Is that clear or not? This point is equal to the sum of this vector plus that vector. And what is that vector? That vector is going to be the direction of the line scaled by some scalar, right? Is that clear? So in fact, any subspace can be represented as a point in the subspace plus lambda times a direction. If I am now in a plane, what I can do is here, I can only do mu plus, I have one thing in the direction u1, and then I move another in the direction u2 to arrive at that point. So in that particular case, it'll be x is equal to mu plus lambda 1 u1 plus lambda 2 u2. Okay? So it's always point in the subspace plus lambda times the direction in the subspace. And if the subspace has dimension 2, I need two directions. If the subspace has dimension d, I need d directions. Okay? So more generally, the way to write this down is, in the case of d directions, that I'm going to have summation of u sub I lambda I. If I have d directions, I equals 1 to d. But this is nothing but I can just put a matrix u that has all of the directions, and then a vector lambda that has the coefficients. Okay? So that's all I'm saying, really, that any subspace can always be any point in a subspace can always be represented as a fixed point in the subspace plus a linear combination of a basis for the subspace. And that's the equation for an affine set. So that's all what is being said here. That's a fixed point in the subspace, a basis for the subspace, and this is just the coefficients of the linear combination. Is that clear now where this comes from? Okay, so I'm going to assume now that I'm given a data point xj, and that the data point xj belongs to the subspace, so it can be written as such. Each data point belongs exactly to the subspace, but I'm going to assume that there is a little bit of error, epsilon j. Okay? And so the goal is going to be find the subspace S that best fits the data. And by best fitting the data, what I'm going to try to do is make sure that that error is as small as possible. So what I want to do, find the subspace S such that I minimize the sum of the squares of the errors. So I'm going to take my errors, I'm going to take the norm of them, I'm going to square them, and sum for every data point. So find a subspace that minimizes the sum of the square of the errors. That's going to be the formulation of the geometric PCA. And I'm just going to go back and substitute here. And so what that means is minimize the sum j is 1. N, and this epsilon j is nothing but xj minus mu minus u times 1. And now the subspace is parameterized by mu and u. So that's what I need to compute. Okay. So that's how I formulate this problem of find a subspace of dimension d that best fits the data. Now, before going down the path of actually solving this problem, it always makes sense in mathematics to ask, is this problem well posed? Does it have a unique solution? Right. Because if the problem is not well posed, then I'm going to have trouble when I'm trying to find a solution. So let's see if that is the case. What could go wrong? So one thing that could go wrong is the following. Suppose that I replace yj, let me add a constant to each one of those vectors. Let me add a constant vector y naught. Okay. And let me take the mu vector and replace it by the same mu vector minus u times y naught. Let me do that. Change. Okay? I'm going to change those values. So then what happens? What happened is that this mu becomes mu minus u times y naught. And this one over here will become u times yj minus y naught. And this guy is going to cancel with that guy, and I'll get the same thing. In other words, I can change the low dimensional coordinates, I can change the point in the subspace, and the objective is the same. That's going to be a bad thing because it means I'm not going to get a unique solution, right? So I need to do something to prevent this from happening. That shouldn't come as a surprise because you should have criticized and said, how are you representing the subspace? Oh, I said I'm going to represent it with one point in the subspace and a basis. But that choice is arbitrary. Why didn't you pick that point? Why didn't you pick that point? Why didn't you pick that point? So that's exactly what's being manifested here, that if I change one point in the subspace by another, I can compensate that by changing the coordinates, and I'll get the same answer. So I need to prevent that from happening. So what would be a simple idea of preventing that from happening? Almost any plot of PCA that you do, right, you've got your data, that might be a gazillion images, and I gave you some examples where I said, you know, this axis is representing moving the head this way, or for the digit example that I gave, right? One was different, you know, you always get two coordinates. Well, I always have the freedom, you know, these are low dimensional coordinates, where do I put my origin? Okay, so what would make sense of where to put the origin? The simplest and the trivial thing that I would imagine is just make sure that your low dimensional coordinates are centered at the origin, right? So I'm going to put the origin exactly at the center of the cloud of points, okay? So what that means is, so this is what I call the translational ambiguity. Give me a name, because I can translate the translational ambiguity. And to prevent this translational ambiguity, what I'm going to require is, I'm going to require the sum of the yj's to be zero. Okay, so if I take the average of the coordinates, it'll be zero. That's the same thing as, in words, this is exactly what I said. I want the low dimensional coordinates are centered at the origin. That's exactly what I'm going to do. So I have my data X is going to be reduced to only the principal component Y, and the average of the Y is going to be zero. That's all I'm saying. Okay? So that's one ambiguity. The other ambiguity is what I call the rotation ambiguity. What is the rotational ambiguity? Well, if I replace u by u times some rotation, and I replace y by, in fact, more than rotational, it's really change of basis. Let me change the name here, I apologize. Change of basis. So this means that I can take u and apply any transformation to it, and I can take y and apply the inverse. Okay? And then mu times u y will become mu times u a inverse y. And this is the identity. And so nothing happens. But again, this is just so silly because you could have told me from the beginning is, well, how do you choose u1 and u2? Any other basis would do the job, okay? So all I'm just trying is to compensate by, you know, I was lazy here. I mean, I need to pick a basis, I need to pick a point, but that's too general. I need to constrain it a little bit more now to prevent the solutions, to ensure, ideally, we would like the solution to be unique. Okay, how would we prevent this change of basis from happening? What would you do? Among all bases or subspaces, which spaces do we like better than others, sometimes? Or for normal bases. So, one possibility is, we're going to constrain u to be, so we are going to assume, or we are going to require u to be orthonormal. Okay? What that means is that I'm going to enforce that u transpose u is equal to the identity of size d. Again, this is a matrix that is d by d. And this is little d by d. Okay. We're going to require it to be orthogonal. Will that solve all of my problems? No, because all what I would do is that instead of allowing any change of basis here, I can just put a rotation and the rotation transpose. Okay. And I'm still in trouble, still not unique. But I am going to ask you to forgive me about that for the time being, and I'm going to demonstrate to you that I can still solve the problem in spite of that issue about the rotation. But I'll come back to it once we're done with the solution. I'll come back to this issue of ambiguity with respect to the rotation. Okay? So, bottom line is that we are going to enforce this constraint requiring the representation to be centered, and we're going to enforce this constraint requiring the basis of a subspace to be orthogonal. And let's see if we can solve the problem now with those extra constraints. So what is my problem then? I think I wrote it over there, is to minimize the sum of xj minus mu minus mu times yj, 2 squared, subject to the sum of the y sub j's must be 0. The u transpose u is equal to the identity. Those are my two constraints, right? By the way, I lied a little bit, or not lied, but I was a little bit incomplete, right? The point in the subspace is unknown. That's what we're trying to find. The basis for the subspace is unknown. But the low-dimensional coordinates are also unknown. Okay? So my optimization problem is really over mu, u, but also over all the yj's. Okay? The only thing I'm given is the beta x. Okay. Yes?
The summation of yj is 0, that is over all the points, or over
yes.
mu?
J goes from 1 to n.
Isn't that over constraining?
Why?
Okay. Should that be, that should be minimum, or that should be 0?
No, these are constraints. Maybe the double dot is such that. What I'm trying to minimize is the minimize the reconstruction error. Subject to the constraint that the low dimensional coordinates are centered, and the basis for the subspace is orthonormal.
Is there always possible to find optimization problem such a way that your low-dimensional coordinates are always centered at origin? You may have a space subspace in which that is not centered at origin, but still will give you a minimizing.
We are going to demonstrate now, as we solve the problem, that it is possible. But in principle, so let's suppose that it is not possible. I set up an optimization problem subject to some constraints, and the constraints are infeasible. This means that I cannot solve the optimization problem. That the minimum value would be infinity. So if I'm able to solve it, and in fact we are going to be able to solve it, and I can even tell you what the solution is going to be. If the mu is taken to be the average of the data points, then the average of the y is going to be 0. And we're going to see why. I think it's easy to see with the derivation. But it's not too strong. Any other question?
No.
Okay, so we're going to do Lagrange multipliers as before. So that's going to be sum j of 1 to n. So the beginning of it hopefully should be super easy. Plus, now I've got this constraint, but important thing, this is now a vector. Okay? A vector constraint. So I have many constraints here in just one, because this guy is a vector of dimension d by 1. Okay? So what I'm going to do is in that particular, in the case of two constraints, what did I do before? Lambda 1, constraint 1. Lambda 2, constraint 2. Remember? Was that clear? So that's equivalent to saying the dot product between lambda and the constraint. So that's exactly what I'm going to do here. Lambda transpose sum of the yj's. J capital N, capital N. Okay? So now I've got a vector of Lagrange multipliers, and this vector is also dimension d times 1, or because I transpose it, it's 1 times d. Okay. But more generally, what I want you to think is that we are going to be doing, with my notation, bracket. For the dot product, it's going to be a vector lambda times all of the constraints. That's going to be the general principle, that I have the objective function plus lambda times the constraint, but it's dot product with a vector lambda prime. Okay, and this abstraction is going to be very important when I write down the next constraint. The next, because now this is a matrix equation, right? This is again the identity, so this is all d by d. So in principle, I have d, little d squared equations written down in there. Okay? Is that clear? So the principle of a Lagrange multiplier is identically the same as dot product between Lagrange multipliers and the constraints. So formally, I'm going to write just that. dot product matrix of Lagrange multipliers of UID times the constraint, which is identity minus U transpose. That is how I go Lagrange multipliers for one constraint to a vector of constraints to a matrix of constraints. It's always the same principle. Dot product between matrix of Lagrange multipliers of the same dimension and sizes as those of your matrix equation of constraints. Dot product with your matrix equation of constraints. Okay? Is that clear how we went from one to two to a vector of them to a matrix of them? Okay. Good. So now there is one thing, however. How many of you have never taken any optimization class in your life? You took calculus 3? Yes? You learn about Lagrange multipliers though. Okay? Suppose that I were to play the following silly and stupid game to fool the Lagrange multipliers, which is to say, I'm going to repeat the same constraint twice. I'm not going to tell the automatic Lagrange guy who's just, you know, brute force writing down the equation. So a stupid Lagrange guy would do what? He would put one Lagrange multiplier for each constraint. But if, what if they are equal? What would a smart Lagrange multiplier guy do? You would realize that they are equal. You would throw away the one that is redundant, and you would put only one Lagrange multiplier. Right? You agree? In fact, for those of you who did take an optimization class, you would remember that once you compute the conditions for optimality, there is something called regularity conditions on the constraints. So the constraints need to be full rank, and so if they are repeated, they're not going to be full rank. But going back to the basics, right? Do you agree with me that if a constraint is repeated, you shouldn't put two Lagrange multipliers to them, and you should eliminate the redundant? Why am I bringing this up here? This set of equations, U transpose U equals to the identity, what does it say? It says that the dot products between the U columns need to be 1 or 0. Is that clear? What about the dot product of U1 with U2 and U2 with U1? They are the same. Yeah, but they are 0, but they are the same. What I'm trying to say is that this matrix on the left is a symmetric matrix, right? Right? So in this equation, I'm saying, okay, I'm saying U1 transpose U1 is equal to 1. I'm saying U1 transpose U2 is equal to 0. But I also have the constraints that U2 transpose U1 is equal to 0. Those two are actually the same constraint. So technically speaking, I do not have little d squared constraints here. I have less than that because the matrix is symmetric. So how many do I have? How many independent entries does the symmetric matrix have?
D plus one over two.
Yes. Right. So roughly d squared over two. So to prevent, you know, not to be a stupid Lagrange multiplier guy, I also need to enforce the Lagrange multipliers corresponding to identical constraints to be the same, because otherwise I'll be in trouble. So all of this is to simply say that the matrix, you know, all of these explanations to try to convince you that I should not let the lambda be absolutely free. I should make sure that the lambda is symmetric. Why? Because some constraints are repeated. If they are repeated, the clean option, what you would really like to do, is completely remove that extra constraint, and therefore you remove the second Lagrange multiplier. But if we do that, we're going to have a problem with, I need to list all of the individual constraints. And I said that I'm a really lazy person. I don't want to work with coordinates anymore. So it looks much more beautiful to just write that matrix equation there. And so because of that, I'm going to say it's equivalent. I'm going to keep the constraint. It's going to be repeated twice. But I'm going to put the same Lagrange multiplier. So it doesn't matter, right? Because it's like saying lambda 1, g1 plus lambda 1, g1 is just 2 lambda 1, g1. So it's really like doubling the Lagrange multiplier for that constraint. But it doesn't matter because I'm solving for them in any case. So implicitly, I'm getting rid of them, but in a very elegant way, by Gluns. OK, so now the problem is well formulated, but I think I've run out of time. Can anyone tell me? 14, so I've got 1 minute. What can I do in 1 minute? In 1 minute, I'm going to prove to you that the optimal point is the average of the data point. Can I do that so quickly? Maybe not. No, I will need to have a redundant. I'll do it next time. So, but hopefully I got the problem formulated.